Hi, my name is Brian and I own a 2022 Subaru BRZ. Like many fellow owners, I'm concerned about the reliability of the FA24, the engine in the second generation BRZ and GR86. I personally know three people who've blown their engines so far. They're all meticulous owners, they've added oil coolers and run 5W30 weight oils, and they've still suffered failures. So a couple of fellow track enthusiasts and I set out to collect real data in order to root cause these issues. There's been a lot of speculation about what's causing these failures, but we wanted to take a rigorous data-driven approach to understanding them. In short, we found that the FA24 oiling system is robust on straights and left-hand turns, but we've been able to consistently reproduce pressure drops on right-hand corners. These pressure drops are most severe in sustained corners, corners with elevation changes, or corners with rapid lateral direction changes. So what does this mean? First, we believe these pressure drops are significant enough to cause bearing damage, even if not an immediate failure. Second, we believe these pressure drops are unrelated to RTV blocking the oil pickup because they've only shown up in right-hand corners. We've been able to reproduce this across multiple cars, including one with the RTV cleaned. We do, however, believe that the RTV is still cause for concern. It's just a separate problem. Last, from our observations, the FA20, the previous engine, is actually more robust against these types of pressure drops. So that's the bottom line up front, but now let's jump into more detail to substantiate these claims. I'm going to cover our testing methodology, oiling fundamentals, I'll go over the evidence with in-car footage and telemetry, and then I'll discuss some theories for why we're seeing these pressure drops. Last, I'm going to talk about what I'm personally going to do to try to avoid catastrophic failure. And a spoiler here is that there's no proven solution that I'm aware of, but I'm testing a possible solution and hopefully we'll have good news soon. Okay, let's move on to testing methodology. We instrumented two FA24 engines and one FA20 engine with oil pressure sensors. The cars we instrumented are first a 2022 Subaru BRZ. This is my car, and I've yet to drop the oil pan, so it's likely there's some amount of RTV in the pickup. We also have a 2022 GR86. CM Auto House here in the Bay Area dropped the oil pan and cleaned out the RTV on this vehicle. And last, we have a 2017 BRZ with a performance package, and we use that to compare the FA20 and the FA24. As for the setup of these cars, the second generation cars with the FA24 have an essentially identical setup. They have no aero modifications, minor alignment changes, and low grip tires, the GT Radial SX2's 225-45 R17. That's a 260 treadwear tire. Unlike folks who experienced failures using high grip tires, these tires actually have slightly less grip than the OEM Michelin PS4 tires. So the engine oiling should be able to keep up with these tires. For oiling, both cars are running Jackson Racing oil coolers with the OEM oil filters. They're both running the exact same oil Motul 8100 EFE in 5W30 weight. For suspension alignment, they're on OEM springs and dampers, OEM ride height. They both have about negative 2.5 degrees of front camber achieved through camber bolts and offset strut mounts. And the rear alignment is OEM and thus not adjustable. It's roughly between negative 1 and negative 1.5 degrees of camber. Our FA20 comparison car has a slightly different setup, which should be able to generate more G-forces and be a more challenging test for the oiling system. It has minor aero, like the factory performance pack wing and a small splitter. It's also running Annex CSP coilovers and the same low grip SX2 tires, but in a slightly wider 235 section width. For oiling, it's running a Jackson Racing oil cooler, OEM oil filter, and 0W40 motor oil. Moving on, another aspect we wanted to control was the driver. So we had four different drivers involved in order to normalize for driver differences. And a lot of the failures that we've seen are in more advanced drivers, but we have a spectrum of experience represented here. So I'm representing the beginner or intermediate driver. I have about 10 track days and a handful of autocross events under my belt. We have a couple of experienced amateur drivers, and then we have a local instructor and private coach, Joe McGuigan. Thanks to Joe for volunteering to help us out. Now on to instrumentation. So we added oil pressure sensors to the engine in two locations, and we logged the data with an AIM Solo 2 data logger. We'll document this separately, but credit goes to No Street Racing 86 for designing, programming, and building a custom circuit board to inject the pressure data into the CAN bus so it could be logged. Real quickly, this is the first location that you can mount the sensor. This is at the OEM pressure switch location, so you take that out and you put the sensor in. And the second location is here on the block. And here's a simplified example of what it looks like when you look at the raw data. Normally, you'd look at a lot more channels of data, but from top to bottom, this shows brake pressure, GPS speed, oil pressure, and time delta. This is three laps around Thunderhill West in each of our test cars. The lap times are all around a minute 30 seconds. Red is the GR86, purple is the 2022 BRZ, and green is the 2017 BRZ. Okay, on to some oiling fundamentals to give context to the data that we'll look at in a minute. In the FA24, the oil pump is located in the center of the timing cover and it's driven by the crankshaft. So the primary input to oil pressure is engine RPM. Secondary factors include things like oil temperature and oil viscosity. On a given lap, those will be relatively constant, so what we expect is the oil pressure will be proportional to the RPM up until it reaches the maximum pressure that the system will allow. In the FA24, that's about 60 psi once it's at temperature. Things like throttle position still matter when you analyze engine reliability due to the load on engine components. So oil pressure drops at wide open throttle are more likely to do damage to bearings, for example. That said, lifting of the throttle should not immediately cause a drop in oil pressure. Again, it should be proportional to the engine RPM. And one other note to help make sense of the data, there's a general rule of thumb for track folks that you want something like 10 PSI per 1000 RPM plus another 10 PSI. So at 1000 RPM, you'd expect to see something like 20 PSI, and at 4000 RPM, you'd expect to see 50 PSI. This chart at the right shows roughly what you'd expect to see on track with pressures maxing out around 60 psi. Take this with a grain of salt, but it's helpful to keep in mind when you're looking at the data that's going to come later. Okay, let's start taking a look at that data now. So we're going to start by getting acclimated to how we're displaying the data. We've got oil pressure, throttle, and brake traces on the right-hand side, in addition to speed and a tachometer. This is roughly everything you need to understand what's going on. So we're starting by looking at some straightaway and some left-hand turns, and you can see consistent oil pressure. Typically, we're sitting around 60 psi. And you can see that this pressure is consistent even in corners with some high load and even with the RPM dropping down a bit. Okay, turn 5 is the first of the problematic corners. We'll do a freeze frame once we get to the pressure drop. And there it is, so you can see we're down at 28 PSI, even though we're at 6,300 RPM. Turn 5 is usually a lift to get a little bit of rotation, and then you turn and you're back on the throttle pretty quickly. And you can see that the pressure drops are happening before we get to the curb, so the curb doesn't influence the pressure drop at all. And we'll watch a couple more examples of this. When we jump over the GR86, the oil pressure is on the top, but the results are just about the same. Now we're going to go on board with the first generation BRZ, and we see a momentary pressure drop, but otherwise very consistent oiling through turn 5, which was so problematic for the FA24. And here's just another example of that. Okay, up next is turn 8 at Thunderhill West. And this is a right-hander that goes over a crest. You're off the throttle and then back on the throttle right after the crest. And we see a pretty significant drop that coincides with getting back on the throttle all the way. and now going back on board the first gen BRZ, we are going to see a pressure drop in turn 8, but the magnitude and duration of that pressure drop is going to be significantly less than the FA24. Okay, and moving on now, turn 3 through 5 at Thunderhill East is a kind of set of S's here. We go around turn 3, which is a right-hander, it's off camber, and we see a lot of fluctuations in the oil pressure here. And then we're gearing up here for turn 5, which is also called the bypass. We've got a big elevation change, and then coming down from this, we're going into a right-hand turn. And again, you see this pattern of elevation and then a right-hand turn being a bad combination. Turn 14 and 15 in Thunderhill East are a set of right-hand turns with a very short connection between them. And you're typically downshifting from 4th to 2nd to 3rd. In this case, we stay in 3rd, and we don't have any issues at 14, but then we have issues at 15. And then here, we downshift all the way to 2nd, and then the issues start showing up in 14, and they'll continue into 15. The last turn we'll show is 9C, and this one's interesting because we go uphill and a left-hander, and then we deal with more elevation change, but we're straight-lining it, and all of that is fine. But then as we go through this right-hand kink with a downhill, we see a pretty significant drop. Not quite as significant as some of the other corners, but still showing that same consistent behavior. Let's take a look at conclusions and theories about what we're seeing. First, we believe that the pressure drops down all the way to 20 psi are a significant concern for bearing health. We believe that these temporary mid-corner pressure drops are not related to excess RTV blocking the pickup. So why are they happening? Well, one theory is proposed by Killer B Motorsport. Oil could be surging forward into the timing cover during braking or lifting as the front of the vehicle pitches forward. The shape of the oil pan may also be contributing as it forms a ramp up toward the timing cover. Then, when you enter a corner and you apply lateral G, the oil can get stuck in the timing cover, this large space shown here. That could lead to starvation at the pickup. Another theory is that the asymmetrical design of the pickup is contributing to this only being apparent in right-hand corners. Here's the FA24 pickup. You can see it's slightly offset, and that's to the passenger side. So in a right-hand corner, the oil will slosh away from the pickup. So where do we go from here? In preliminary tests not shown here, we've seen that horizontal baffle designs haven't really addressed the large pressure drops we're seeing. Instead, I'll be installing a prototype baffle from Killer B Motorsport that they've specifically designed to address the oil surging into the timing cover hypothesis. I'll be tracking my car in the same corners with the same data logging setup to see if there's an improvement in oiling. Finally, I'd like to say thank you to the drivers and car owners that have made this test possible, Joe McGuigan, Miles K, No Street Racing 86, and a thank you to Killer B Motorsport for working on this problem and for giving me the prototype baffle to test. And just as a bonus, here's a complete lap around Thunderhill West where you can see the pressure drops in context.